إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد أيها الأحبة في الله سؤال أوجهه إلى الرجال والنساء إلى الرجال والنساء أيضا والسؤال هو متى آخر عهدك بالقبور؟ وبعبارة أخرى إمتى آخر مرة زرت المقبرة؟ ألم تعلم أيها المسلم أن النبي محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم قد حثنا على زيارة القبور؟ كما جاء في حديث بريدة رضي الله عنه وأرضاه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كنت نهيتكم عن زيارة القبور ألا فزوروها فإنها تذكركم الآخرة يقول عليه الصلاة والسلام كنت نهيتكم من زيارة القبور نعم كان قد نهى الصحابة رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعين عن زيارة القبور وكان ذلك في أول العهد حينما كان الصحابة حديث عهد بالجاهلية فكان يخشى عليهم إذا زاروا القبور أنهم يقومون بأعمال لا تليق بالمسلم ولكن لما استقر التوحيد في قلوبهم ولما امتلأت نفوسهم نورا أمرهم الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بزيارة القبور وقلت السؤال موجه إلى الرجال والنساء حينما سألت متى آخر عهدك بالقبور ولعل سائلا يقول ماذا تقول يا شيخ يعني النساء تزور القبور فأقول لكم نعم النساء يشرع لهن أن تزور القبور ذهب إلى ذلك جماهير أهل العلم أما الذين نهوا النساء من زيارة القبور فدليلهم حديث اختلف في صحته وهناك أدلة قوية جدا تدل على جواز زيارة النساء القبور وليس هذا موضع نقاش الأمر ولكن الراجح من أقوال العلم بل ذهب إلى ذلك جمهور أهل العلم جواز زيارة النساء القبور وأيضا ليس هذا وقت ذكر الآداب فلعل البعض يخلط بين الآداب وبين الحكم Let me begin by asking a question and this question is addressed to both men and women. And the question is, when is the last time you visited the cemetery? When is the last time you visited the graveyard and stood over those graves? Are you aware that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged us to visit cemeteries? He encouraged us to visit the graveyards? In the hadith of Buraydah radiallahu anhu wa ardah, he says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I used to forbid you from visiting the graves, but now visit them, for indeed they remind you of the hereafter. So in this hadith, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I used to forbid you from visiting the graves. And that is because in the early days, when his companions, radiallahu anhum ajma'in, had first entered into Islam, they were very close to the time of ignorance. And in the days of ignorance, when they were non-Muslims, and they used to do things and say things at the grave sites which are inappropriate for Muslims, which are, as a matter of fact, forbidden for Muslims to do. But when their faith was solidified, when their souls were purified and filled with light, with nur, then the Prophet ﷺ permitted it, and he ordered them and he encouraged them to visit the graves. You may also recall that at the beginning, when I asked that question, I said it is directed towards men and women alike. So a person may ask, so are you saying that it's okay for women to visit the cemeteries? They can go to the grave sites? And my answer is yes. As a matter of fact, this is the preponderant opinion, or the opinion of the vast majority of scholars, that it is permissible for women to visit the grave sites, for them to visit cemeteries. As for those who forbid it, then they base their opinion on a hadith which the authenticity of is debated. So the authenticity of the hadith which they use to prevent and to forbid women from visiting cemeteries is debated. Its authenticity is debated. And there are many authentic ahadith which indicate that it is permissible for them. This is one of them. كُنْتُ نَهَيْتُكُمْ أَلَا فَزُورُوهَا. The Prophet ﷺ says, yeah, I used to forbid you. Now he says, go and visit the grave sites, the graveyards, the cemeteries. And this is addressed in general to both men and women. In any event, this is not the time for me to get into the details, but suffice it to say, this is the opinion of the majority of scholars. And let's not confuse between the ruling and between the etiquettes. So while it is permitted for us to go, we also have to follow certain etiquettes which apply to both men and women. Let's not just single women out. If men do certain things that are inappropriate at the gravesite, it's forbidden for them to do those things, just like it would be forbidden for a woman. على كل حال حينما نزور القبور من المستفيد إذا زرنا القبور. الحقيقة أنه يستفيد من ذلك الزائر والمزور. المقبور أيضا يستفيد. أما الحي الزائر فلا شك أنه يستفيد. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ماذا قال؟ فإنها تذكركم الآخرة. يعني الإنسان إذا زار القبور سيتذكر مسيره، سيتذكر أنه غدا سيكون مكان هؤلاء. الإنسان الذي يزور القبور ماذا يرى؟ يرى أمامه قبورا متقاربة. نعم هي متقاربة، ولكن القبور نفسها متباعدة من ناحية أخرى. فترى قبرا وبجواره قبر، وهذا الأول له من الحسنات ما لا يخطر ببال، فلذلك درجته عند الله سبحانه وتعالى عالية. وأما الآخر وهو بجوار الأول فقد ذهب إلى قبره وسجلاته مملوءة بالسيئات والمعاصي، فهو في حفرة من حفر النيران، بينما الأول في روضة من رياض الجنة. القبران متقاربان ومتباعدان في الوقت نفسه. إذا زار الإنسان القبور قصر أمله في الدنيا ومن قصر أمله في الدنيا خشع قلبه وإذا خشع قلبه صلح وإذا صلح القلب صلح الجسد كله كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So this issue of visiting cemeteries, visiting graves, who benefits? The reality is that the visitor as well as the visited both benefit. Both of them benefit. As for the one who visits, then they benefit because as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it reminds you of the hereafter. Indeed, it keeps us focused. When one of us visits the cemetery, we see all these graves in front of us. And these graves are side by side, close to one another. But do you know something? At the same time, while they are close, they are also far apart and distant. How is that? Imagine this. You visit the cemetery and you see the grave of an individual who lived his or her life according to the way of Al-Islam, according to the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved to see them live. They went to their graves and they had in their book of deeds many, many righteous deeds recorded for them. And so they are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the highest of levels. Whereas perhaps the grave just next to that one is inhabited by an individual who lived a life filled with sin and transgression. An individual who was disobedient towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That person went to his or her grave and their book of deeds is filled with nothing but disobedience and transgression and sins committed against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So their grave is like a pit from the pits of the hellfire, whereas the grave of the first is like a piece of paradise. The difference between them, you see, they are near to one another, but look how far apart they are in reality. The difference is what they took with them to the graves. The one who visits the graves, the living one, benefits. How? They benefit because when they look upon these graves, they lose hope in a long life on this earth. In other words, they realize that they're not going to live forever. And they realize that tomorrow they will be in this place. Such a person will benefit. Why? Because once you don't cling to this world, as many people do, then your heart submits. And if your heart submits, it is purified and rectified. And we all know from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that it's all about the heart. Once the heart is healthy, and we don't mean physically, we're talking spiritually. Once the heart is purified, then the rest of the body will be purified as well. Amma al-maqbur fa kayfa yastafid? المقبور يستفيد بدعاء الزائر له الزائر يستغفر للميت الزائر يسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن ينور على المقبور قبره وأن يفسح له فيه أيها الحبيب تذكر هذا وأنت في المقبرة قد يكون أن الساعة التي حضرتها كان أهل القبور يعذبون ثم وقفت على تلك القبور وَسَأَلْتَ اللَّهَ جَلَّ وَعَلَىٰ بِقَلْبٍ خَاشِعٍ أَنْ يَرْحَمَهَا أُولَٰئِ الْأَمْوَاتِ سَأَلْتَ اللَّهَ جَلَّ وَعَلَىٰ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ وَأَنْ يَعْفُوَ عَنْهُمْ سَأَلْتَ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَىٰ أَنْ يَمْلَأَ قُبُورَهُمْ نُورًا. تصور أنك تسأل الله جل وعلا ذلك كله وأنت مخلص وقبل الله جل وعلا دعاءك. فما النتيجة؟ ما النتيجة؟ هؤلاء المقبورون يتوقف عنهم العذاب وأنت سبب في ذلك، لأنك دعوت لأخيك بظهر الغيب. وهنا أقول أنت أيضا أيها الزائر مستفيد. كيف؟ لأن على رأسك ملك يقول لك آمين ولك بالمثل. Even the buried, the inhabitants of those graves, even they benefit when we visit the graves. And I want you to picture this. Imagine that you happen to go to the cemetery and you're standing before those graves, and it so happens that the time that you are there is the time that they are being punished in their graves. But of course, when you go to the graves, when you go to the cemetery, then what are you doing? What you will do, of course, is you will pray for the deceased. You will make dua for them. You will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His mercy upon them. You will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them and to pardon them. You will be asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to widen their graves and to fill their graves with nur, with light. Imagine that you are doing that while you are present in body, in mind. You are there with your soul and your heart, and you are sincere. Imagine that you make this dua, you supplicate for them in this manner while you are sincere, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts your dua or supplication. What's the result of that? If Allah jalla wa ala accepts your supplication, He will stop that punishment. The punishment for those in their graves will cease. So do they not benefit? And here let me say that you also benefit. Because when you make dua, when you supplicate for a fellow Muslim, while they're not even with you, it's not that you're supplicating in front of them where you can benefit from them. They're gone. Did you know that there is an angel who is appointed to you? That every time you make a dua, you supplicate for them, you ask for good for them, that angel will say, Ameen, which means, O Allah, accept. Accept this dua that this person is making for the deceased. وَلَكَ بِالْمِثْلِ. And he says to you, and likewise for you. That is, the angel is making dua for you as well. So this is another way in which even the visitor is benefiting. أيها الأخيار زوروا القبور وأقول مرة أخرى يا رجال زوروا القبور يا نساء زرنا القبور وتذكروا جميعا حديث أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه وأرضاه حينما يقول قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يتبع الميت ثلاثة أشياء تتبع الميت حين يذهب به إلى المقبرة فيرجع اثنان ويبقى معه واحد يَتْبَعُهُ أَهْلُهُ وَمَالُهُ وَعَمَلُهُ فَيَرْجِعُ أَهْلُهُ وَمَالُهُ وَيَبْقَى عَمَلُهُ. أي والله حينما يذهب بك إلى قبرك لو قيل لأحد أقاربك لو قيل لزوجك لو قيل لزوجتك لو قيل لابنك أو ابنتك لو قيل لأبيك أو أمك لو قيل لأحد كان متعلقا بك في هذه الدنيا ابق هنا معه ابق مع هذا الميت سندفع لك المليارات ماذا سيقول ذلك الحي يقول لك معذرة عندي حياة لابد أن أعيشها العاقل لن يقبل أن يبقى مع المقبور لا يمكن ذلك يرجع أهله أقرباؤه محبوه كلهم يرجعون لا يبقى أحد وماله أي والله هذا المال الذي نجمعه ليل نهار هذا المال الذي نموت من أجله هذا المال الذي أصبح غايتنا في هذه الدنيا ماذا سيفعل به هذا المال الذي جمعته أيعقل أنهم يضعون هذا المال معك في قبرك البيت أو البيوت الفاخرة أيمكنها أن تذهب معك السيارات والدولارات لا شيء يذهب معك وإنما بعد أن يرجع إن كانت الأمور على ما يرام فتوزع تركتك أموالك بين الورثة ولكن كما نرى في هذه الأيام الغالب أن ورثتك سيتقاتلون على أموالك افهم هذا جيدا يرجع مالك أيضا وما الذي يبقى معك؟ عملك يبقى معك صلاتك يبقى معك قراءتك للقرآن يبقى معك برك لوالديك يبقى معك صلتك لرحمك يبقى معك الصدقة التي كنت تنفقها في سبيل الله جل وعلا يبقى معك حسن معاملتك للناس إحسانك بالخلق هذا كله يبقى معك يبقى مع شخص إهماله للصلاة يبقى مع شخص بخله وعدم التصدق في سبيل الله يبقى مع شخص عدم بره للوالدين بل عقوقه للوالدين يبقى مع شخص قطيعته للرحم يبقى مع شخص إساءته للغير هذا ما سيبقى معه يتبع الميت ثلاثة فيرجع اثنان ويبقى معه واحد يتبعه أهله وماله وعمله فيرجع أهله وماله ويبقى عمله زر القبور وتذكر هذا الحديث انظر إلى تلك القبور واعلم أنها إما حفرة من حفر النار أو روضة من رياض الجنة روضة من رياض الجنة إذا كانت معه الصالحات وحفرة من حفر النار إذا كانت معه السيئات يبقى معه واحد ألا هو عمله. I encourage myself, then my brothers and sisters, to visit the graves. Go to the cemetery. And when you go, remember the hadith of Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu wa ardaah, in which he says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the deceased, a person who dies, when they are being taken to their grave, three things follow them. Three things follow them. But two of those things will return while one of them remains. Those things which will follow that person are his family, his close ones, his wealth. In other words, that wealth is still his property or possession, and his deeds. Those three things will follow the person. The two things that will return are his relatives, his family, those who are close to him, and his wealth. And what will remain with him are his deeds. And of course, when I say his, you know, you're mature enough to understand this refers to both men and women, his or her. Tayyib, imagine this. And it's going to happen sooner or later. This is going to happen to each and every one of us. Our bodies are going to be taken towards their final resting place in this world. This is before the hereafter, which is the grave. Those who loved you, your family members, they will follow along with you. And if one of them was offered $1 billion or billions of dollars to remain with you, to keep you company in your grave, what do you think their answer will be? Thanks, but no thanks. I have a life to live. No sane person is going to accept remaining with you in the darkness of that grave. Nobody's going to keep you company. They will all return. فَيَرْجِعُ أَهْلُكَ, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. As for your wealth, you know that wealth and that property that people now have made the goal of their lives, that wealth for which we literally kill ourselves, that wealth that we are running after, the dollar, those fancy homes and the fancy cars, all of these things, what's going to happen with them? Your bank accounts, are they going to go with you? Which sane person is going to bury your wealth with you? Or if you own the mansion, are they going to bury you in that mansion? And if they did, what benefit is there in that? What joy are you going to get from it? Your wealth will also return, meaning that it will no longer belong to you. Do you know what's going to happen with your wealth and your property after you leave this world, after I leave this world? And it's going to happen. It's going to happen. What's going to happen? Well, if things are going well, if things are peachy in your family, then after you go back, they'll take a look at your will, or they'll remember what you know you had advised, and your estate will be divided up amongst your heirs peacefully, insha'Allah ta'ala. But let's be realistic. What's most likely to happen? What's most likely to happen is what we see day and night nowadays. And that is that those heirs of yours, meaning that family of yours that you left behind, will probably be at each other's throats. They'll probably be fighting over what you left behind. Your wealth will not remain with you. So who's going to leave you? Your family and your property. It will no longer belong to you. You will have no use for it, as a matter of fact. What will remain with you are your deeds. Ah. The salah that you prayed 5 times a day, all those voluntary prayers that you offered, they will remain with you. The charity that you gave will remain with you. Your dutifulness towards your parents will remain with you. Your maintaining of family ties will remain with you. Your kindness towards people, towards your neighbors, and so on and so forth, will remain with you. All of those deeds, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, they will remain with you and they will benefit you. Or, Allah forbid, if you're not of that category, then your neglect of salah will remain with you. Your stinginess and miserliness and lack of willingness to spend for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the wealth that He provided you with, that will remain with you. Your cutting off ties with your relatives will remain with you. Your undutifulness, your cruelness towards your parents will remain with you. Your poor behavior with others will remain with you. And none of that will benefit you. As a matter of fact, it will cause your grave to be like one of the pits from the pits of hell. Wal'iyadu billah. So once again, I encourage myself and everybody else to visit the graves. فَمَرَّةً أُخْرَى أَقُولْ زُورُوا الْقُبُورُ اتَّعِذُوا اتَّعِذُوا تَذَكَّرُوا مَا قَدْ قُلْنَاهُ الْيَوْمِ ونسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أنه حينما ندفن ونقبر أن يملأ قلوب قبورنا نورا وأن يفسح لنا في قبورنا. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، أيها الأخيار، موضوع لا يتعلق بالموضوع الأول لكن لا بد من ذكره، ألا وهو ما سيحدث بعد يومين في هذه البلاد، وهو الاحتفال بعيد يسمى هالوين. قد تحدثنا كثيرا عن حكم الاحتفال بأعياد الكفار، وقلنا إنه قد أجمع العلماء على تحريم الاحتفال بأعياد الكفار وعلى تحريم تهنئتهم في أعيادهم. هذا الأمر لابد أن نفهمه. اعلموا أننا مسلمون، لنا ديننا ولهم دينهم، وهذا العيد بالذات يحبه الأولاد، وكثير من المسلمين لا يرى بأسا إذا شارك أولادهم غيرهم في هذا العيد. وأقول إن سمحت لأولادك أن يشاركوا غيرهم في هذا العيد فقد اعتديت عليهم، اعتديت عليهم. هذا الأمر إساءة إلى أولادك، كونك تسمح لهم بالاحتفال بهذا العيد وبالاشتراك فيه، يعني أنك تمهد لهم الطريق إلى الجحيم. أي والله، أقولها علنا وبملء فمي، بملء فمي، هذا يعني والله، أقسم بالله ثلاثا، والله ثم والله ثم والله، لو سمحت لأولادك أن يشاركوا غيرهم في هذا العيد فهذا دليل على عدم حبك لأولادك. بهذا تقول لهم تقول لهم أقروا هؤلاء على ما يفعلونه بهذا تفتح لهم الباب إلى نار جهنم افهموها جيدا والله هذا اعتداء وهذا عيب وهذا دليل على خفة العقل أي والله إنك إنسان سفيه غبي إن سمحت لأولادك أن يشاركوا الغير في هذا العيد الذي هو عيد للكافرين للمشركين فكيف تقر أولادك على هذا الباطل والله حتى هذا سيذهب معك إلى قبرك وغدا ماذا سيحدث بأولادك سيرون أن أعياد الكفار لابد أن نقرهم عليها والله سبحانه وتعالى لعنهم وأنت تقول لهم معليش لا أنا لا أقول أنا لا أقول حرضوا أولادكم على الإساءة إلى هؤلاء لا بل أقول لا تتركوهم يشاركوا الكفار في هذا العيد وسأعود وأقول ما قد قلته مرارا وتكرارا هذا اليوم يوم الجمعة ماذا فعلت لأولادك في هذا اليوم هل أولادك منذ أن أصبحوا شعروا بعظم هذا اليوم هل ينتظرون أولادك آخر النهار حينما يأتون إلى البيت وهم قد خرجوا من البيت ولبسوا أحسن ثيابهم وحرصت على أن يتطهروا في هذا اليوم خصوصا لأنه يوم عيد أسبوعي ماذا فعلت لأولادك في هذا اليوم حتى تسمح لهم بالاشتراك في هالوين أو في غيرها من أعياد الكفار سؤال إذن أيها الأخيار لا يجوز أبدا أن نترك أولادنا يشاركون غيرهم في هذا العيد الذي هو من أعياد المشركين خلوهم في البيت هو يوم عادي مثل أي يوم ولا نحتاج إلى بدائل البدائل موجودة شهر رمضان بديل شهر يوم عيد الفطر بديل عشرة العشر من ذي الحجة بديل يوم عيد الأضحى بديل المحرم بديل ونحن احتفالاتنا ما هي؟ هي شكر لله وعبادة لله سبحانه وتعالى نصوم ونصلي وإلى آخره ونفرح أيضا في العيدين ألا نفرح في كل جمعة ألا نفرح إن كنا لسنا من هؤلاء الذين يجعلون يوم الجمعة يوما عظيما في بيوتنا إذن نحن المقصرون نحن المقصرون لا تقول لي يا أخي نحن في البلاد وكذا طيب يا أخي أحسنك والله ترجع بلدك معناته لا تأتيني بهذه الحجج نحن مسلمون سواء كنا في السعودية أو في ماليزيا أو في كندا أو في بريطانيا نحن مسلمون لا تنسوا هذا الأمر very quickly A topic that is not really related to the topic of today's khutbah, except that I have to mention it. Because in 2 days' time, we know that it's going to be Halloween. Halloween, which is one of the holidays of the pagans. It's a holiday of the non-Muslims. And I have said repeatedly, and I will say again, it is a matter of consensus among the scholars that it is forbidden for Muslims to participate in the festivities and the holidays of the non-Muslims. As a matter of fact, it is forbidden for us to even congratulate them on their holidays. Those holidays are theirs. لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينٍ For them is their religion and for us is ours. Remember that we are Muslims. And that is what matters. It doesn't matter where in the world you live. We are Muslims and we have our religion and we have guidelines in our religion that we have to follow. Because we live here, it doesn't mean that we have to go with the flow. If they're doing something wrong, it doesn't mean we do wrong as well. This is one of the things that will go with us in the grave, by the way. Make certain that you in no way, shape, or form participate in this holiday. You don't congratulate people, you don't do anything out of the ordinary for this day. Don't give candies out at your home. Keep it dark so nobody comes. If they ring the doorbell, don't answer. It's a normal day for us. And them ringing on your door, knocking on your door is it's just them bothering you. So don't let them bother you, just let them go. You don't have to open the door. There's no law that says you have to. Keep the door shut and end of story. Your children, do not allow them to take part in anything to do with Halloween or any other non-Muslim holiday. It is your responsibility as a parent not to allow them to take part in these holidays. If you do, then I want you to understand something. What you are doing is you are paving the path to the hellfire for them. Yes, I swear by Allah, I swear by Allah, and I swear by Allah a third time. If you allow your children to take part in Halloween or any other non-Muslim holidays and festivals, then it is a sign that you do not love your children and that you are abusive towards your children. This is abuse. Instead of teaching them who Allah is, and instead of teaching them love for Allah and His religion, Al-Islam, what are you teaching them? You're teaching them to approve of holidays which are cursed by Allah. Does that sound like love? That sounds to me like abuse. You're opening the doors to hellfire for them. That is what you're doing. I'm sorry, but if you allow your children to take part in Halloween or any other non-Muslim festivals, then you are foolish. You are feeble-minded. You don't know your head from your feet. You don't love your children, because if you loved them, you would want them to enter paradise. So you would teach them how to attain that goal of entering paradise. Not open the doors of the hellfire for them. Understand this and understand this well. I don't care that we are living here. If that's the problem, then go back to where, to some country that we don't have to live this way. Go to some other country where you, this is not an excuse. Nobody forces us to do those things here, so don't use that excuse on me. It is very important that we maintain our Islamic identity and we don't water it down. We don't want to become a part of that melting pot. We are Muslims and we have to be proud to be Muslims, and we have to teach our children that. And we don't need some alternative. So we don't need to make it halalaween. A'udhu billah. What are you talking about? Talk about following in the footsteps of the non-Muslims, which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited. Why do we need that? We have no need for it. It's like any other day. Teach your children. You know what? That's part of their way. That's not part of our way. And teach them that it is an evil thing. Look it up with them on the internet. Show them what the origins of that holiday are. And that is why it's wrong. Teach them that we have much better things. Teach them about the month of Ramadan, about Eid al-Fitr, about the 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, about Eid al-Adha, about Al-Muharram and the fasting in Muharram and Ashura. We have lots of wonderful things in our religion. Our festivities and our holidays are not about drinking and eating and so on and so forth. Sure, we enjoy ourselves, but listen, what are they all about? They're about showing gratitude to Allah, about praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want alternatives? What have you done for your kids? Let's take today, for example, Friday. This is a weekly Eid of ours. Are your kids excited? They can't wait to get back home because they're going to have that special meal? For example, how many times have I spoken about this? Because, you know, in the morning, they were reminded, today is the day of Jumu'ah. خَيْرُ يَوْمٍ طَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسِ. The best day that the sun has ever risen over. Do your kids understand that? Were they reminded of that this morning? Did they notice how you were more careful for them to take a bath and to be well-groomed and that they wore their best clothing today because it's the day of Jumu'ah and it's an exciting and a blessed day for us? If they don't know that, but they know Halloween, Houston, we have a problem. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الكفرة والمشركين اللهم دمر أعداء الدين وأهلك الزنادق والملحدين اللهم انصر المجاهدين في سبيلك في كل مكان اللهم ثبت أقدامهم واربط على قلوبهم وأنزل السكينة عليهم وانصرهم على عدوهم وعدوك يا عزيز يا قوي اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان اللهم خذ بأيديهم وعجل بنصرهم يا عزيز يا قوي اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا اللهم من الراشدين اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين قوموا إلى صلاتكم رحمكم الله